I'm going to talk about Tectonic, all the stuff that Luca talked about that's up there above all the operators. And maybe really quickly about me. I'm a test engineer at Chorus here in Berlin right now. You can find me pretty much anywhere on MXIND, and feel free to reach out if you don't want to ask questions during the talk or after the talk or whatever. All right. Kubernetes plus something is Tectonic. So today what I want to talk about is this something. And I hope most of you are familiar with Kubernetes. Who's not familiar, or who is familiar with Kubernetes? I think that's a lot better question. Okay, so, perfect, that's very good. Okay, what is that something? So that's what I want to talk about today, and hopefully what you learned today. So if you want to think as Kubernetes, you can think of Kubernetes as the kernel and Tectonic as the distribution around. So we package it nicely and make it usable very easily. And what we right now advertise Tectonic with is certain buzzwords. So first of all, high availability. Everybody wants his cluster high available. You want the applications high available, but if your cluster is not, that's pretty much nonsense. Then there's self-hosted. We got a very opinionated way how to run Kubernetes. We're very much involved in the Kubernetes development. And this is one of them. I'll go into detail. Automated operations. We wanted to make it as easy as possible for you to use Kubernetes. Kubernetes is already helping you a lot, but actually Tectonic makes it a lot easier on top of that. We're secure by default. I'll go into detail what that means. And we bring in time monitoring stuff. So, for example, we have the Prometheus team in Berlin, and they integrate nicely with Tectonic or do all the integration. Okay. To get Tectonic, we have Tectonic Installer. It's all open source. You can check it out on chorus.tectonicinstaller. And it helps you setting up Kubernetes the CoreOS way. I'll go into detail what the CoreOS way is, which is kind of opinionated here. The main logic is implemented all in Terraform. That might help you if you want to edit it to your own needs. So you can do that all in Terraform and adjust it to your setup. And actually, you can use it to spin up a vanilla Kubernetes as well. So if you just want to play around with Kubernetes itself, you can spin up vanilla Kubernetes the CoreOS way and try it out. Right now, supported platforms, this is the order which we support it the best. So AWS is definitely on the very top. We've been supporting that, I think, from the very beginning. Bare Metal after that. We just added Azure support. I think we're still in alpha. Next release, we're in beta on Azure. And OpenStack and VMware. VMware is still to come, and OpenStack is not fully there yet. OK, and to make this more interesting, this talk, I'm a little bit afraid, I'll do start a Kubernetes cluster right now. And we'll talk a little bit about what happens here later. I hope the network works. I hope all our resources on AWS are fine. And so on. Let's just do this. You don't have to worry about that. I'll go into the browser later. all right. So to start up Kubernetes, let's just talk for now and ignore that. So I talked about the CoreOS way and how. What is the CoreOS way of running Kubernetes? Well, what's very most well known about the CoreOS way how to run Kubernetes is self-hosting. The idea of self-hosting Kubernetes. Some might think it's crazy, it's insane. Some might think it's a really good idea. I'll explain why we chose it. And the idea of self-hosted is you host your Kubernetes cluster inside of Kubernetes. But not just any other Kubernetes cluster, but actually in the same Kubernetes cluster. So you might think of the chicken and egg problem, and I'll explain how we solve this chicken and egg problem. So we're running Kubernetes inside Kubernetes, all the components of Kubernetes inside the same Kubernetes, and so on. You can think of self-hosting in different layers. The lowest level is Kubernetes add-ons like the DNS server and other add-ons. Those are really easy to self-host, to run in your own cluster. If you're on this level, it basically means you got all of this already started. So starting just a simple deployment of something is not as difficult because there's already scheduler and controller manager, API server, and everything already in place. So now it gets more difficult and more difficult the higher you get in the self-hosted layer. The scheduler might be possible, the API server, self-hosting that, who do you actually talk to? etcd, where do you save all your state? And kubelet, who actually starts all those pods? So it's really difficult, and I go from here. The Tectonic installer actually supports self-hosting until level 2. That's version 1.6.7, that's the current one. And if you trigger the experimental flag, we actually give you a self-hosted etcd as well. And what I do today is go into details how we actually bootstrap this. We do that, it's all open source, how we bootstrap it. It's a Kubernetes incubator project, it's Bootcube. Check it out on GitHub as well. And how this works is, you got your node, and on that node, you need two things. First of all, you start up the kubelet. I hope you can read this. The kubelet, let's say, was a systemd unit file. And in addition, you start up Bootcube. That's just a container that you start up your node. And now Bootcube is going to start all the rest, or make sure all the rest is started with the help of the kubelet. So first of all, what Bootcube does, it assumes the kubelet is started. That's what you have to do. We're not going to take that away from you. Then second of all, what Bootcube does, it makes the kubelet start up a bootstrapping cluster. This cluster that I'm talking about is just a very temporary cluster. We don't care about it, we throw it away at the end when our real cluster is started up. And what I mean by make kubelet start something is the Bootcube just takes a bunch of YAML files, put it in the folder that the kubelet expects them, and then the kubelet sees, oh, there are YAML files, I have to start something up. So it starts up our temporary etcd cluster, our API server, our scheduler, our controller manager, and so on and so on. So all the components that we actually need. Once this is done, we got a full-blown Kubernetes cluster here, but we don't have it the CoreOS way, it's self-hosted, but just the components started on your kubelet. And from here on, we got a running Kubernetes cluster here, and what we can do in a running Kubernetes cluster is schedule load. So now, what we're going to do is actually start our real Kubernetes cluster as load on the bootstrapping cluster. So what we're going to do is, with that upper Kubernetes cluster, start an API server, start etcd, and start a scheduler. So now we have two etcds running, we've got two API servers running, and two schedulers. And you might think they interfere with each other, they fight against each other. Well, first of all, in terms of the API server, that doesn't really matter that much. It's supposed to be stateless, even though it's a daemon set right now, deployed as a daemon set. Then etcd is just a cluster next to it, and the scheduler was really nice. Well, the two schedulers, they decide who runs right now at this moment via Kubernetes redirection. Just a feature that you can use over the API server. You can actually use it for your own apps. If you want to check that out, it might be interesting. So right now, the first scheduler started up first. The second scheduler came along, so there is already a scheduler that leads the cluster, so it doesn't do anything, it just idles around. So basically, the lower part just doesn't do anything at this moment. Now, when this is all started up and everything is ready, what Bootcube does, it transitions all the data, all the state from our bootstrapping cluster, so from the etcd of our previous cluster, into our new cluster. It does that all with the Prometheus etcd operator, which helps a lot. I'll go a little bit into detail what that does. So now we've got all our state duplicated in our new cluster as well. So the new cluster is pretty much ready to go. And what Bootcube does as a last step, it just kills the bootstrapping cluster. Now when you kill, for example, the scheduler, the other scheduler notices, oh, there's no leader, so I have to take over, I'll lead from now on, and it takes over and runs as the number one scheduler. The same for the controller manager and so on. So this is how we made this chicken and egg problem possible, as we are running this Kubernetes cluster actually in our own Kubernetes cluster, and Kubernetes is aware of all the components and we can manage them. Okay, why? Right? Why all this complexity? Why would you do that? does anybody have a question towards us? It is a little bit complicated, but no? Okay. So why would we do this? First of all, it adds a lot of complexity. It's not that easy, it's difficult to spin up. But a nice thing about this is small dependencies. The only thing that you need on your node is boot cube and the kubelet. And that's all you need to start up a Kubernetes cluster. No other components. Everything else is just in Docker containers. And we just use Docker containers for all of that. From there on, we have deployment consistency. You already, as an operator, you already know how to deploy your application on Kubernetes. Why not start your Kubernetes the same way you run your applications on-site, onto Kubernetes? You have easy introspection. So all the tooling that Kubernetes already offers you to introspect into your application, you can now use to introspect your own Kubernetes cluster. So for example, you can look at the logs of the API server and so on, just as you would look at the logs of a normal pod. Then upgrading, what's a huge story at Chorus, you can go with cluster upgrading as it's just components inside your Kubernetes cluster. And we have easier, high availability configurations. So you can scale your application in your Kubernetes cluster, but what we can do as well is just scale our API server this way. I'll go a little bit into detail how this is not conflicting each other, I think, in the next couple of slides. Okay, self-hosted. Now, next up is high availability. What is high availability all about? Of course, we want a high available cluster, so that means we want everything several times and make sure it doesn't die. And I talked about the lead election before. What we, for example, can do is run two schedulers next to each other. They don't interfere with each other as there's lead election over the API server. And this way we run those two schedulers, and if one dies, the other one takes over, and we're highly available here. The same counts for the controller manager, for example. But now the problem is all this lead election takes place over the API server. So whenever the API server dies, there's nobody to talk to anymore, and there's nobody who does the lead election. So then the schedulers are completely lost, and they don't know what to do. So that's why there's this little application called Checkpointer. And Checkpointer just goes over periodically, goes over all your core components that are really important, and snapshots them. So snapshots the configuration of the pods, and writes those to disk. And whenever one of those components is not present, so it can't snapshot them, it just starts them again via the kubelet. So it basically just pushes the YAML to the kubelet, and you're up and running again. The same, for example, counts for the API server as well, and for all core components. And what is really nice about this is when you, for example, run your Kubernetes cluster on CoreOS at Container Linux, and you need to restart your operating system, if you restart your operating system, everything is gone, right? Nothing is started anymore. And no API server is there to communicate. So what this checkpoint actually did is make sure to put these YAMLs, those checkpointed YAMLs, into the upstart process. So whenever your operating system starts back up, the kubelet starts back up, and then the API server starts back up, and you're up and running without problems, with no downtime. With downtime for sure, but with no interference by QB. Okay. Next up, we got the high availability. Now, Kubernetes is a very fast moving project, so we want to do self-updating as well. And self-updating can be difficult as there are a lot of components, but that's the idea why we do self-hosted, because now we cannot only update the application without problems, but we can also update all your core components. And in the end, this just boils down to, we do a kubectl edit on the daemon set kube API server. So you just edit your API server and change the container image version. The API server and Kubernetes itself are gonna start up a new API server, and you just have to kill the old one, and you're up to the next version. So really easy to update it. The same thing counts for the kube scheduler. Here it's a little bit easier as it's just deployment, so you can do a rolling deployment. You can, of course, you should run in high availability, you should run multiple, with multiple schedulers, and then you can just roll and deploy each one and roll and update each of them. Now, this is easily done with kubectl, so that means we can automate it nicely, and that's taken care of by the kubeversion operator, which you get with Tectonic as well. So we take care of the updating, and you just have a fancy little button in the UI, update my Kubernetes cluster, and it takes care of it. Okay, secure by default. A lot of people might have heard of RBAC, role-based access control in Kubernetes. The idea behind Tectonic is that we have it on by default, and that we do deny by default. So everything has to be allowed, everything has to be whitelisted. So we can control every communication. Then in addition, we, for example, give you an identity provider that we'll see later on as well. And we do all the TLS encryption for every critical component in your cluster. By default, just shipping with Tectonic. Okay. Moving from here on, I talked a lot about operators. Really quickly, what is an operator? I think most of you already heard the term way too many times. We take knowledge about how to operate our applications, put it into code, and we get an operator. And that operator we deploy in our Kubernetes cluster, and it takes care of it, right? It, for example, in Prometheus, it helps you spin up Prometheuses. The etcd operator helps you spin up etcds, and so on. So here with Tectonic, or with the open source etcd operator, you already get a lot of help. We're actually doing the bootstrap process. We're using this etcd operator as well. This helps us for self-hosted etcd, and you can also spin up your own etcd clusters. And from here, I would like to move on to monitoring with Prometheus. And of course, there's the Prometheus operator. We call everything operator now. And let's go a little bit into monitoring, and then let's see what our cluster actually did while I was talking. I hope it's something good. And then I can demo this very quickly. So, who's familiar with Prometheus? Okay, pretty much. Nearly everybody. Prometheus is a monitoring system. It goes to your targets, whatever that is. That might be the Linux kernel, that might be the application. Everything exposes a slash metrics endpoint, either by default or via some exporters, and Prometheus scrapes those. And it goes along every now and then, it follows the church of pull, so it's a pull-based monitoring system. And what you give Prometheus is some alert definitions, what is a bad state of your cluster, and then Prometheus knows what a bad state of your cluster is, goes over its data every 1 minute or something and checks if the bad state is the current state. And whenever that happens, it sends an alert to Alert Manager, and Alert Manager groups, deduplicates, and routes those alerts to your teams, and then sends it on to one of our integrations. There's a huge amount, it's just not those three. You can be alerted by page or duty, but you can have email as well, of course. And surprise, surprise, of course we have the Prometheus operator here. It helps you automate, manage, and upgrade your Prometheuses and your alert managers, and it makes it Kubernetes native. Now, the idea behind this is we as Prometheus maintainers know best how to run Prometheus, and we definitely know best how to run that Prometheus inside of Kubernetes. So why don't we give you that knowledge? But we don't want to write docs, but we want to write code, so we give you that as code inside as the Prometheus operator. So now you only have to deploy that Prometheus operator inside the Kubernetes cluster, and we basically take care of the rest. What I mean by Kubernetes native configuration is you all know deployment YAMLs, and instead of deployment YAMLs, when you want to create your own Prometheus, you can write Prometheus YAMLs. Okay. We use that Prometheus operator to do the cluster monitoring. So with Tectonic, you get full monitoring of your entire cluster. You get a Prometheus cluster that is monitoring all your cluster components. What is really nice about Kubernetes, it's exposing Prometheus metrics by default. So everything can be scraped nicely. And what we do as well is setting up alerting rules. So if we're all running Kubernetes, we are all not very amused if our API server is down, so why don't we write alert rules as a community here and collaborate on that and write the same alerting rules and use them all. Actually, all of this is open source, at least the alerting rules. I'll point you where that is at a later point. In addition to the Prometheus cluster, we do the same with Alert Manager. We configure that each other know of each other, and then Prometheus, whenever something happens, can alert Alert Manager, and you just have to configure Alert Manager to your Slack and to your email, and then we'll redirect everything. Okay, now the part I'm most afraid of. Apply complete, okay, it's a good thing. Let's see. I was too lazy setting up certificates, but what you see right here is our Tectonic console. So what we did, I just set Terraform apply in the console here, and what happened is Terraform goes along, spins up a cluster on AWS, and now here, there's the UI of that cluster. I've just got my domain, mxinternet.dev.cores.systems, and here's our full cluster. And this UI is not the Kubernetes native UI. This is actually the UI that comes with Tectonic, maybe a selling point for Tectonic. And what I want to show you here is now that we're actually self-hosting all of this. So self-hosting would mean we're running everything in your cluster, and that means Kubernetes is aware of your components. So let's see if Kubernetes or this UI actually knows of all components. So if I go to pods here and I select the kube system, you, for example, see the etcd operator. You see the kube API server. So that's already a major self-hosted component that we're having here. This is really cool that we can just run it inside of our Kubernetes cluster. And you got the controller manager, you got our etcd nodes actually running inside of your Kubernetes cluster right now. So we have to, I did activate the experimental flag and our networking pods and everything. So everything is in here. And in addition to kube system namespace, we also have the Tectonic system namespace. And what you see here is you get your alert manager cluster, container Linux update agent. Luca covered that, and all kinds of different stuff. For example, a node agent who takes care of exposing metrics of your node. And somewhere in here should be a Prometheus cluster as well. Here, up here, we got the Prometheus cluster as well. Okay, that is Tectonic. Next to that, we also expose Prometheus and the UI. Nope, not here. Hope it started up. So now some of you might be familiar with it. This is the Prometheus UI. We can just show these are all the metrics we are scraping by default. It's a huge amount. It's every major component of our cluster right now. I was talking about alerting rules. For example, all open source. You can use them for your vanilla Kubernetes cluster as well. There's a deadman switch, which is always firing. We'll see that in Alert Manager. And these are all of the targets that we're scraping right now. And the last thing I want to show is the Alert Manager. No, I'm done. So this is the new Alert Manager. Zoomed, it doesn't look so good. So amazing. And this is a deadman switch. So you see the pipeline is actually working. So Prometheus triggers the deadman switch and sends it on to Alert Manager. And the only thing that is missing here right now is now you configuring where you want your alerts to send on. I'll not go into detail on the deadman switch, but please feel free to reach out afterwards. Okay, this went really well. small recap, really happy here. We talked about what that question tag is. It's Tectonic, it's high availability, it's self-hosted, the crazy idea of the chorus, it automates all your operations, or at least we try to make as much automated as possible, and it's secure by default. And lastly, it was really nice, you don't have to set up all Prometheus stuff, because that can be quite tedious from time to time, as Prometheus can do so much. But instead, we do that all for you. Where can you go from here? Well, Cora's Tectonic Installer, it's open source. Just check it out on GitHub. It's all there. You can adjust it to your own means, whatever you want here. And then there's Prometheus.io with great documentations how to get started on Prometheus. And of course, the Prometheus operator, which helps you setting up your own Prometheus clusters inside of Kubernetes. Okay, I don't have the hiring slide in here because Philip already covered that. And that's me. Thanks for your attention. Any questions? Yes?
If you do self-hosted, what do you do with the volumes like etcd?
Volumes right now? So right now we don't take care of the volume management, so we mount them in from storage providers from your cloud provider.
Okay, so if I'm on bare metal or don't have a storage provider, I cannot do that.
I think you can configure, so either you have Ceph or something, or I think you can configure etcd to use the local storage, if I'm not wrong, but you have to trust your nodes then a lot, I guess. Yes.
Please. Can you show us setup grading the 1.7?
Sorry?
Can you show us setup grading the 1.7?
I cannot. we've not yet updated to the newest Hypercube image. I think we're about to do that in the next 2 or 3 days.
It's on Quay already.
The PR is out. Sorry?
It's on Quay already.
Sorry? It's on Quay, yeah, for sure, but it's not on the Tectonic installer. The PR is open. I think it's just 2 line changes, just changing the Hypercube image. Check out the PR if you're really curious. I'm sorry. I'll show you.
Thanks for this though.
Okay, any other? Yes?
Which part of Tectonic are open source and which part are not?
Okay. So the UI is not open source. Most of the operators, as Luca said, the lower level is open source, and whatever we need to mix and match with Tectonic itself are not open source because the whole Tectonic thing is not open source. So etcd operator right now is open source, so that will help you with etcd all the management. And I think it makes sense to use the etcd operator even without Tectonic. Then there's the Prometheus operator, which is open source as well, and it definitely makes sense to use that. If you're running on Kubernetes, definitely use the Prometheus operator to run your Prometheus instances. Then there's all the stuff that Luca already covered. I don't think I should go over that again. Bootcube is open source. So spinning up in Kubernetes plus a WISP bootcube is all open source. Tectonic installer is open source. It's all open source. You can use it. Hypercube, of course, that's just the builds that we run for Kubernetes is open source. What am I missing here?
KubeState Metrics is open source.
Sorry?
KubeState Metrics is also open source.
Yes. What else do we got?
It's just a cube version operator line, but that's what it's still called.
Do you know that we're hiring?
I work on the Prometheus operator, for example, because Prometheus operator is it's very limited options you can select, and pretty much just one option if you scale your cluster. So it doesn't share it, just creates you one good cluster which doesn't last you enough.
Sorry, I'm a little bit confused.
Yeah. So the problem is the Prometheus operator. It does create new shards for Prometheus.
Mm-hmm.
So and you cannot explicitly set up any parameters that you want to set up in using Prometheus resource inside Kubernetes API. So it's very limited by now. So it's,
you mean the operation of Prometheus with the Prometheus operator?
Yes.
What exactly are you missing there?
A lot.
Well, I think maybe Frederick is first.
I can answer all
the
questions.
Okay.
All of them. All of them. Whatever you want to ask, is the answer.
Okay.
I want to join the meeting, but
me too. Yeah, I actually work on the Prometheus operator.
Yeah, that's the way he was working on this.
Any other questions? I don't know. What if that dies and this dies? Or anything?
Can we clear up on the components in the cluster?
Sure. But we can kill an API server if you want to. But yeah.
Kill it.
I don't know how to increase the font of my job.
Control plus. Gives it the
Can you read something?
Yeah. Okay.
Does Tectonic Salt support the Federation yet?
Does Tectonic support the Federation? I don't think so. No.
No, but there is multiple other support. Like you can stay within the same UI and switch between clusters.
Okay, what do you want to kill? The API server?
Be quiet.
Scheduler.
Yeah.
You're embarrassing me.
Should trigger in the room?
Hey. Well, yeah. Alright.
It'd be more impressive just to kill the node that the API server's running.
I can kill AWS if you want.
All of it! Which one? This might crash everything. Definitely not prepared for this. Put a -W on the end, we'll see how it terminates.
Sorry, what? There we go. Let's see if it comes back up. I'm not sure. There we go. Yeah.
Wait, it's terminating.
Still terminating, okay.
There.
Yeah, the new one. Ooh. So, let me think what just happened.
Lots of it.
So we killed the old API server, but what we are doing at all times is checkpointing that API server. So we are writing down that YAML configuration, and whenever our API server is not present to checkpoint, we notice, hey, there's no API server, so we should probably start that up, and we tell the kubelet.
You probably want to mention that you're running a single master node, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so
apply the label.
The reason why there's a high availability in your cluster is just because
there's
a single master node. If you put multiple master nodes, you'll also get multiple APIs, multiple etcd nodes, ports, and stuff like this.
Yeah, that's
true. And so this makes this problem even easier to fix. Because then one of the other sort of just take off.
Yeah. And because using BookCube, it's as easy as just adding a label to another node and it becomes a master automatically.
Okay. So, yeah, it can work with just one master and one API server. I'm not going to kill anything else. See ya. Any more questions?
One final question, Paul. Do you guys have any plan in terms of scaling? Like, since you are using Prometheus for monitoring some stuff, would you suggest or do you have any feature that covers all the scaling?
I think Kubernetes already has some feature around that, but it's not wrapped around Prometheus. I don't think we're planning something right now. But
are you talking about scaling your Kubernetes cluster itself or your applications running within Kubernetes? No, I'm talking about in node level.
Okay.
That we're not working on yet. The other part where you're auto-scaling your applications, that is being worked on.
All right.
So I mean, right now you have Heapster that you can auto-scale applications with, but it's being replaced with something called the Core and Custom Metrics API. And there you can just plug in any monitoring system that you want. So The first adapter that's actually being developed is for Prometheus. So starting the 1.7 release cycle, you can actually use Prometheus to auto-scale your applications running in Kubernetes.
Okay. But nothing in terms of nodes.
You can still build something yourself for that, but there's nothing that we ship.
It's quite easy with BookCube because you just drop your cube config file in etc Kubernetes and it automatically joins the cluster.
Yeah,
but someone must trigger this process at some point.
Yeah.
Or an alert.
Cool, thanks. Nice talk.
Alright, anything else? You can reach out afterwards as well. Alright.